Let's stand and look at God's word in Genesis chapter 11, verse 31. Were you blessed yesterday? Yes. All right, stand to your feet. Let's look at God's word together. Genesis chapter 11, in verse 31. The Bible says, and Terah took his son Abraham, his grandson Lot, Haran's son, and Sarai, his daughter-in-law, his son Abraham's wife, and set out with them from all of the Chaldees for the land of Canaan. But when they got as far as Haran, they settled down there. And in verse 32, Terah lived 205 years and he died in Haran. Father, we ask for the blessing on your word today, and I pray you take my tongue, make it like the pen of a ready writer. Cause me to speak a word in season to a man, a woman, a boy, or girl who is in need of your words. I pray that, Father, you will wing these words by the power of your spirit, minister to our hearts, bring precision, bring impact. Let there be revelation, let there be impartation today, to the end that your people will be established in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Can I have a good amen in the house of God? God bless you, please. You may be seated in the presence of God. Now, I want to say this, and that will be happening when my father comes up to pray for you. There is a conference taking place here in Houston, and it's going to be this Saturday. TJ, it's going to be this Saturday. Yes, sir. So we're going to get the details, all right? So that we can pass it across. So you're going to get me the details in the end of the conference so we can pass that across. You don't just want to miss that. If you're talking about modern day prayer, online prayer today, that you find most of us, myself, Bolaji, Jerry, and the rest of us, all of that you see us doing, what many won't tell you is that Apostle Goodart was the first to open up that platform for all of us. So he started that for many of us to begin to follow. So it would be great for him to release such dimension of grace upon your lives today. Let's get straight. I'm told Apostle Humphrey is in the house. Can we honor the man of God? Thank you so much, sir. You've been here so patiently. We honor you, man of God. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. Wow. All right, so my interaction with you is going to be very brief and straight. And here's what I want to do so that you can get it. I think it would be better for me to illustrate it because of the younger generation. One of them walked up to me yesterday. She said, Pastor, I don't like going to church, and I don't listen to pastors because they just throw too many scriptures at you. And repeatedly yesterday, most of the young people who were here were telling us that yesterday made it easier for them to understand the Bible. Is that true? Yeah, I'm sure that they said, look, Pastor, you made the Bible relatable to us yesterday. I guess they said with the storyline, the way it was presented, made it easy for them to be able to follow through. So as I just thought about that, I said it would be nice for me to also establish that premise today so that you can be able to understand what we're trying to do. Can I have three individuals here? Just three men. Quickly. Yeah, Pastor Inka, can I have you? Let me have you, sir. Okay. So it's a very simple narrative, but that's going to give you a great understanding. And if I have something like a veil, a cloth, a shawl, or something, thank you so much, sweetheart. Okay, go get that for me. And by the way, would you please help me celebrate my girlfriend of 22 years? Listen, you don't know why you need to help me celebrate. I'm the first to cross the line in my family to be married to one woman and stay with her for 22 years. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. I'm saying I'm the first in my... They don't stay that long in my bloodline. 7 years is more than enough. They get bored with women. So when the men stay with women for 7 years in my family, they're like, no, I'm tired of this. They just go somewhere else. My father did it too. So 22 years, one woman keep me in prison. I can literally see my ancestors saying, son, you are the best version of all of us. Across the line. Amen. You will understand what I've just said now by the time I'm getting into my message. Say, I cross the line. Fantastic. God bless you. Be seated for a moment, sweetheart. Thank you. So the Bible sets out, the Bible gives us this great narrative about a man by the name Terah. And I'd like you to look up here now. The Bible gives us this narrative about the man by the name Terah. Terah happens to be the father of Abraham and the father of Haran. And the Bible made us to understand that this great man called Terah, at some point in his life, did what an average, reasonable man must do. And the first thing every man must do in order to lead a family is to have a clear vision. Every man who wants to lead a family must have a clear vision, which was the first thing that Terah did. He conceptualized a vision, whether by inspiration, by information, or by revelation. We do not have the premise for understanding how Terah came about his own vision. Whether he walked with God, the Bible is silent about that. So we do not have details about his relationship with God. But for the fact that later Abraham was called by God to pursue the same vision, presupposes that maybe his father had some inclinations towards God. But let's start with the father. So the Bible made us understand that the father had this vision, and the vision was very clear. He said to his children, you know, that's what I love about vision. The father was able to gather his children, come together. He gathered all of his children. And when he gathered all of them, he said to them, so who's going to be the father here now? Okay, so father. All right. So the father was able to look at Aaron and look at Abraham. And the Bible says he looked at them and he said to his sons, he said, my sons, I have a vision. And he said, we're going to leave the country where we're in. We're going to leave the land where we're in right now. And he said to them, we are going to the land of Canaan. So it was very clear. Some of the challenges we're dealing with today in Africa and in African-American communities, which I've studied so very wide, is that you have a challenge amongst our men in the African-American community. There's a problem of clarity. So an average woman lines up behind a man who doesn't exactly know where he's going to, but pretends like he knows. And nothing really frustrates a woman like lining up behind a man who is confused. It's so frustrating to know that you are equipped to help a man who is going nowhere. Nothing brings a woman alive like finding a man whose vision swallows her giftings. That the man's vision is like an ocean, and your talents and giftings, the one you brought into the marriage, eventually will just be swallowed up in the marriage in terms of the size of the vision of the man. You will have to develop new skill sets in the marriage to be able to cope up with the vision of the man. Am I talking to somebody in the house of God? How do you know you've married a man who qualifies to be your leader? How do you know? There's something about his vision that will let you know that your current skill set requires improvement. But the worst thing is for you to be married to someone who you begin to realize that your skill set is way beyond his conceptualization, his vision, his dreams, his imagination, and you're trying to help him figure him out. So the Bible says, because that's not my focus today, and I don't want to deviate from what I'm here to talk about. So the Bible says that this man had a clear vision, and very so clear, he was able to communicate the vision. He said to his children, we are going to the land of Canaan. That's exactly how our vision should be. Write the vision, make it clear. It should be so clear as we are going to where. We are about to make how much? We are about to build what? We are about to accomplish what? The vision must be clear. So we must celebrate Terah for the fact that he had clarity of vision. He was able to communicate it to his children. So he said to them, let's go to Haran. And then the Bible says they began the journey. They started the journey and the boys began to follow him. But here's where the trouble, like I want everybody to look at this now. And then the Bible, watch this, the Bible said they came as far. They came as far as Haran, and the Bible says there, for whatever reason, as it happens to a lot of visionaries, they came so close but far from where they started, from their origin to their point of destination. When they got over to Haran, the Bible says the man, for whatever reason, we do not have the details in scripture, but we're told that when he got to Haran, a man going to Canaan could no longer go forward. And I'm sure that someone will begin to understand what I'm talking about. As you look at your life, is this where you intentionally wanted to go to? Is this what you said you wanted to become at the beginning? Is this what God showed you? Was this what you really wanted to do with your life? Was this what you wanted to become? Is this what you have thought? Is this what God said to you? And the reality is that most times we start so well with so much zeal and so much fire, like many of us at the beginning of a year. You're like, this year, I'm going to finish the whole of my Bible, right? And then you started from Genesis with so much fire. And then you got to Haran, the book of Leviticus. And as you got to Leviticus, and then you began to see the blood of goat, two bulls and two dove. And you began to see blood everywhere. But before you know, you just found out it's December and you've not left Leviticus. You've not even crossed over to Deuteronomy. Somebody understand what I'm talking about? Right? You set out and you said, this year, I'm going to be praying 3 hours, 4 hours, 1 hour every day. And you started with so much zeal and zest and fire. And somewhere along the line, here you are today, and you can't even recognize your prayer life anymore. You started with 1 hour at the beginning of the year, and right now, 5 minutes, you don't even know what to say in the presence of God. There are three stages in the journey to life, three stages. And I hope that your pastor will hear that, and the leadership. And I'm so blessed by your leadership, the people that God has blessed you with. I said to them back in Abuja, I said, for the first time in the history of our church starting anywhere, we have never assembled the quality of leaders that TJ has assembled together. I mean, the quality of leaders. Now here is where the trouble lies. Life has three stages or phases. One is what we call start. The second is what we call middle. And the last one is what we call finishing. Or you call it your destination. It's been discovered that so many start so well, but right in the middle, we lose our steam. Somewhere in the middle, which is what I call the Haran syndrome, you get to a point and then you suddenly lose your steam. You lose your fire. You lose your passion. Sometimes it might be as a result of troubles. It might be as a result of challenges. Sometimes they are unexplainable reasons. Sometimes they are so diabolic that your mind cannot be able to decipher what caused your stop. Sometimes the reason why we stop is because we never anticipated the storms that we got to meet on the way. And sometimes the shameful part of it is that sometimes we get to meet with comfort too early, and comfort becomes the adversary to our progress. Whatever the case was, please, I'd like you to look at this. He got to Haran, and the Bible says he couldn't cross the line. He stopped. And it's so sad that the Bible says he stopped here. He was supposed to go there, and he died here. And part of our assignment here today is to make sure that someone doesn't die here. That someone doesn't end here. That the ministry meant for there doesn't end up here. That the business destined for there doesn't end up here. That the marriage meant for there doesn't end up here. You all know how that many marriages start with so much romantic moments, kissings, and we just take pictures, text each other at work, and you know, we're just so engrossed, just so in love, and you know, I can't even concentrate at work because, you know, all of that in the formative stage of the marriage, in the embryonic stage of the marriage. And then look at us now. We ask ourselves a question. Do we recognize each other anymore? We've all come to Haran where we couldn't cross over, so everybody has to go his path. Everybody has to go his way. Because I do few things with your government here in the United States, I do some few works with your government, and I don't talk too much about that in the public. So I do few stuff with your government, and the amazing part of it is sitting down with some of your people, and I was sharing Apostle Tomi's church. There's a book that all your presidents are expected to read. All presidents are expected to read that book. It's called Democracy in America by Alexis de Tocqueville. Amazing book that reveals to you the average nature of an American person. How that we are so generous and at the same time we can be greedy. It's just almost like an oxymoron. You know, and it goes on to tell you about our founding fathers, how we migrated from England and then we're settling in the New England, and how that when we came over to the East Coast, settling down from Virginia down to New York, every part of the Eastern Coast. And as we came over, I mean, as the American fathers came over, now here's something I love about that book. It said they saw forest, they saw woods, but as they were looking through the woods, they could see cities built. And they moved into the woods and began to build cities. But the challenge is that after they build cities now, it seems we can't see farther than the cities we have built. So to innovate is now a challenge to us. And so you get to places like Pittsburgh in Pennsylvania, you get over to Pittsburgh, and you still see some of our older irons that we use to make our bridges. Everything still looks, you know, you go around the city here, you begin to see memories of what it used to be years ago. And someone is like, are we stuck? We used to see what has happened to us. Here's the point. Everyone will come to a moment in your life where you have to deal with what we call Haran. Haran is that place not too far from where you're going to that wants to keep you from moving forward. It could be challenges, pain, it could be prosperity, what I call premature prosperity. It takes a lot of discipline and grace for you to recognize that this is not that. Am I talking to somebody? It takes a lot of grace for you to recognize that this is not that. Let me give you a story that will further strengthen what I'm trying to say. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 3, we had a story of a man by the beautiful gate. And the Bible says he was born lame. But here's what I saw about that scripture. His friends will carry him, come support him. His friends will carry him. And then the Bible said they will bring him to the gate. They bring him to the gate. And the Bible said when they get to the gate, for whatever reason, they had all the energy to carry him out of the house. And when they get him close to the entrance of the temple, for whatever reason, their energies comes to a standstill, energies famished, and then they put him by the gate. This went on repeatedly for years. His network, his association, the kind of people within his cycle couldn't take him beyond the gate. I just wanted to say this Sometimes, in order for you to go beyond where you are, it will require the interplay of people who are not currently within your space. Am I talking to somebody? In order for you to go beyond where you are, you will need the interplay, the invasion, the incursion of people who are not currently within your space. So the Bible says they bring him over to the gate, and at that point, they back off. And he also doesn't have the strength to cross the line. But glory be to God, the Bible says on a particular day, two men of God came his way. Come out. Now, these are men who themselves have crossed the line. No one can take you beyond where they've not been. Am I talking to somebody here? No one can take you into something the person has not experienced. That's why the Bible says the less is blessed by the greater. You can't bring me into something that you have not experienced yourself. That is why for Moses, don't miss this now. That is why for Moses, in order for Moses to bring the children of Israel out of Egypt, Moses had to go to the wilderness first. So Moses knows the wilderness he was going to bring them out into. Are you getting what I'm saying? But look at the trick in scripture here. Now watch this carefully. When it was time to go to the promised land, the biggest error Moses committed was that Moses stayed back and told 12 spies to go. They moved into the promised land and he did not go. And you can't take a people into a place that you have not been to yet. So we needed a Joshua from amongst the 10 out of the 12. The 10 of them disqualified themselves. When they got to the promised land, they came back. They said, we are not able to get in there. God said, as you have spoken, so shall it be. But Joshua said, we are well able. We have crossed over, so we can take them over. A leader must be the one who has gone ahead and comes back to bring the people to the place. That's why in true worship, no worship leader can take you to the presence of the one they have not been to. You are not a credible witness to be telling people to come into something you have not experienced. You're not a credible witness. So follow me carefully because we're about to pray. So the Bible says there were two men, all the friends in his life, and I'm talking to you right now, all the friends in his life, this is how far they can take him. This is how far they brought him. They've done this for years. Every time they carry him, they get to the gate, they stop. And then the Bible says, here we have these two men coming from outside this cycle. And they came and stood before him. And they said, look on us. And as he kept his eyes on them, the Bible says, they said to him, silver and gold have we not to give you, such as we are, because you've been used to this, but it has never changed your life. We're not going to give you what you're used to. Because what you are used to will only keep you where you've always been. I'm going to say that again. The reason why you will continue to remain where you've always been is because you're always going for what you've always gotten, what you've always tasted, what you've always done. Until your routine is altered, it is very obvious that there's not going to be anything significant happening in your life. You can predict what the future can look like or will look like by studying your current routine. If nothing changes in your cycle, nothing is going to change ultimately in your future. So God had to bring two men outside of his own cycle. And that's one of the things we're going to be praying for that God will do for you. That God will bring people outside of your cycle to be able to break the tangent, open up a new vista for you so you can move into a new dimension. Now, the reason I'm taking time to explain this is so you can know what you have been anointed for. Because sometimes in church we just come for the anointing. I think sometimes we just come for the oil. Now, what is the purpose for the oil? Are you aware that whenever oils have been applied on people, they were told what the oil is meant for? So when a priest is supposed to be is going to be ordained, they make him to know that this oil coming on you is for priestly function, not for prophetic functions. And then when the oil was being poured on David, he was made to understand, as this oil is being poured on you, it's for kingship. But we live in a day whereby it's just the oil. Anoint my head for what? So today we want to be very clear about what you are being anointed for. And I want you to follow the story and I'll soon be done. So they came over into his life. And they said, silver and gold have we not, such as we have, we give unto you in the name of Jesus. Rise up and walk. Look at what they did. The Bible said they gave him a hand. And the Bible said when they pulled him up, watch this. The Bible says, and he came, take him out of it, move, cross. He was able to cross the line. And you know the thing that amazed me the most? The moment he crossed the line, the Bible made us understand what was inside his heart. It was then we got to realize that his greatest desire had always been to enter the temple. This man will have died there if not for the hand that came to help him to cross the line. Help me look at your neighbor and say to the person, you will cross that line. Say to that person, you will cross that line. Study the income bracket of African Americans. Study the income bracket of African Americans in America. It will shock you. Right now in Canada, there is a major crisis for people who are migrating to Canada. Right at the top of the chain in Canada, you have a situation whereby people from Asia and some other places are right at the top. People from African and African American, or African descent, so to say, are the ones at the bottom of the rung. Statistically proven. And now Africans are coming to the reality of this singular fact, that those who are at the top of the game do not play by the rules. That the rules are made to exclude you. And so, you know, you talk to Africans, they will tell you, you know, when Africans get over to America, to Canada, you hear them making statements like, you know, I've left my country where there are no rules. I've come to a place where everything is by the rule. And I'm like, really, you think everything works here by the rule, by rules? I said, no, in this place, relationship trumps rules. And you know that this is the same thing in America here. If you keep going around thinking, well, I'm just going to give all my best and I will just do my work. And you need to do that. But you need to realize that it is a limited way to advance in life, because relationship in this country trumps the rules. Rules are made for some. There are some that the rule doesn't apply to. You see that every time when you see judgments being passed. Look at your incarceration rates right here in Texas. Your social justice system. And it is done in such a way, sir, can go back there, sir. Your social justice system is done in such a way whereby there are many, generationally, there are many who may never cross the line for the rest of their life, because their grandfather didn't cross the line, their father didn't cross the line, and we have a generation also that may not be able to cross the line. We play church. There's so much church in this country. And the reality of the matter is that we are way behind. I came here to challenge you. I came here to challenge you. Help me look at someone around me and tell the person, I will cross this line. Oh, say it like you mean to say, I will cross this line. Say it like you mean to say, I will cross this line. There are women here who just need to say to yourself, educationally, there are men who are here who need to say to yourself, what is the educational line that I need to cross? Okay? I came from that kind of family. That's the kind of family I came from. Grandfather never went beyond standard 6. My father never went beyond standard 6. So looking backwards, there's nobody from my bloodline that I can look up to and say, this person went to the university. Nobody. Everybody wanted to. I remember my father wanted to. My father served in the military, and I remember how that my father wanted to advance himself. But he couldn't cross the line. And I literally watched my father die behind the line. I watched my father die, never crossing the line into his dreams. And my father watched his own father too die. And it seems this thing has been perpetuated across generations. And then I gave my life to Christ. And 1992, I will never forget, a Saturday prayer meeting was going on. And a man of God began to teach in this area. And I held the chair at 8 p.m. The meeting came to a close and people were leaving the hall. And I held the chair. And I said, God, you've got to break this pattern in my life. Grandfather never went beyond this line. Father never went beyond this line. God, you've got to break it in my life. 1992. And on that day, I had one of the most amazing revelations, one of the most amazing encounters of my life. All of a sudden, I saw a sword come and cut off the loop that connects me to the bloodline that I come from. So I am the first from my bloodline to make it through undergraduate days, go postgraduate, have my doctorate by the grace of God, and I'm still going for more. Am I talking to somebody in the house of God? I'm the first from my... Now listen, that may not be so much accomplishment from where you come from, but it's so much from where I come from. That's the line nobody crosses in my bloodline. I was talking to my son recently and we were just having a conversation. And I said to my son, I said, look at you. I said, you are at this age and you are in your final year in the university. I said, at this age, I was still figuring out how to get into the university. Why has that happened? When someone crosses the line, it makes the pathway easy for others. That is why today you have to become a line crosser. You've got to cross the line so you can make the path easy for others. So for some of us, it's an educational line you have to cross. Since you had your first degree, that seems to be the end of it. Why don't you go beyond that? That's the same thing that runs in your bloodline. It's an educational line. Nobody crosses it. And you know the funny thing about the adversary? Whatever he notices will advance your destiny is what he keeps you away from pursuing. My wife comes from a family whereby all the women in my wife's family, from her mother, one of the things that has happened is the fact that they just had their children out of wedlock. And then her stepmother looked at her and told her, the same thing is going to happen to you. So my wife happens to be, and you know, funny thing that happened, I didn't even know about that part of the story. But when my wife and I were getting ready to get married, I bought her a pair of shoe, amazing shoe. I bought that for her. You need to be generous as a man when you're dating a girl. You're just... See, listen, as a guy, you need to show her what the future is going to look like. All right. So I bought her this beautiful snakeskin shoe. Yes, ma'am. I bought that for her. And when I brought it, my wife was so excited about it. And, you know, this was 1992. And my wife came to me. She said, can I ask you for something? I'm like, my head moves a little bit fast. Is that okay? So I'm like, yeah. She said, I'm sure you're not going to tell me no. My mind began to like, this question may be tricky. So I said, no, there are three answers to this question. Number one is yes, no, or wait. And then she said, can I hug you? I'm like, wait. And she was like, she said, but you just hugged Sister Joy. And that was true. On my way upstairs, I just hugged Sister Joy. And I hugged some other sisters in the fellowship. She said, well, you just hugged all of them. I said, yes. She said, why not me? I said, your name is Mary. I said, your name is Mary. And the only thing the angel told Joseph was, wait. You got to wait. I said, no hugging. I can hug any other person, but it's dangerous to hug you. Sorry, that's just Mary and I. Is that okay? So I said, no. And I did not know that one of the major challenges in that bloodline is sexual compromise. And I did not know that someone has put a word on her that she's also going to have a child out of wedlock. So, but we had to cross. She had to cross the line. You know what? As soon as she got married, all of a sudden it was like the veil was taken away from everybody else in the family. And people, listen, everybody had to go back to formalize their marriages. I'm telling you why you need to cross the line. Lines you don't cross, your kids will have to confront. It is the reason why when, come, sir. It is the reason why when Tara died, could not cross the line. Get out of the scene, sir. Get out of the scene. Guys, come here. Watch this. Haran also died. My question is, how did you even get to name your son Haran? In Haran. Eventually, Haran also died out of the equation. And then the Bible says we're left with Abraham. Listen to what God said to Abraham. When God was going to call Abraham, he said, Abraham, come out of your father's house. I want you to get your eyes away from the physical father's house. Can you be metaphorical a little bit? So can you come out from the way your father thinks? Can you come out from your father's philosophy, your father's mindset? I hope you are not a replica of your father in the way he thinks, the way he reasons, particularly in the negative side of it. I hope your father's negative culture are not your predominant culture. Come out from your father's house. I hope you're not pursuing life like your father pursued life. I hope you're not laid back like your father was laid back. My mother had to call me. My mother said, son, I want to talk with you. I just finished a meeting like this, deliverance service, and people were falling all over the place. Deliverances were taking place. And after the meeting, my mother was in that meeting. And after the meeting, my mother said, son, can I see you? And I followed my mom to a quiet place. And she said, congratulations, I see what the Lord has done. My mother is a very blunt person. And my mother said, I see what the Lord has done with you today. She said, but I want to tell you something. She said, you see all the things God used you to deliver the people from? She said, it's also in your family. And I'm like, what? And she said, number one, let's start with, she said, the men in your bloodline procrastinate a lot. That they always have opportunities, but they don't take advantage of them. There's always something about them that says, okay, I will do it tomorrow. She said, your father had the opportunity to buy lands. She said, but your father ended up not having anything when he could have bought so much. Number two, she said to me, she said, there's something else about the men in your bloodline. I said, what is it, mom? She said, the men in your bloodline, if you see any of them having access to lands, they own a land. The land is not a land they bought by themselves. All the men in your bloodline, the lands that they own, women give it to them. Number three, she said, the men in your bloodline have this penchant to have children out of wedlock. She said, your father thought he could escape it, but your father became a victim of the same. So nobody has been able to cross these lines. Nobody in your bloodline has ever traveled out of Nigeria to Ghana. As simple as that may sound. And she began to list out. And you know what I did? I took note of everything my mother mentioned that the men in my bloodline could not overcome. Praise God. And I said to myself that I'm going to cross this line. Please help me welcome up Prophet Tomias. And I said to myself, I said, look, I'm going to cross this line. Is there anybody like me here today who is saying, Reverend Sam, I'm going to cross this line? Is there anybody? Listen, we didn't come here for joke. It's not about us looking good. It's not about us being looked at as superstars. Our joy, like I said to you yesterday at the conference, I said to you yesterday, my greatest desire is that you live here empowered. I want you to leave this conference and know exactly what you encountered here and what happened to you. Amen. And I took a list. I wrote it down. No man in your bloodline. And then my mother said, no man has ever built a house of his own. No man. And I said, God, you've got to help me. The last thing my mother said to me, she said, no man has ever served God in your bloodline. They all come from Christian homes, but they end up not going to church. So all through my father's lifetime that I know my father, never did I see my father go to church. The only time my father went to church was at the age of 51. I took my father to church. And this was a year before my father died. So I had so much to contend with. And please, I want to say something here so you don't play with this. Because I know where I came from, I understood that the way I'm going to pursue life will be different from someone who doesn't come from my kind of bloodline. You can take life easy because you came from an easy background. I didn't come from such a place. I am a dry shoot from a dry ground. Am I talking to somebody in the house of God here? I am not a child that was born with a cap on the head. I am a child that came out with a head without a cap, and you have to learn to fix the cap, create the cap, build the cap, and put the cap on yourself. For 10 years, 2010 to 2020, literally every week, almost every week, I finish church on Sunday, and I get out on Sunday night, and I come into America. I come to run courses, and by weekend, I'm back to Abuja, and I go to preach. I have some of our people here. Sometimes I will have to go do the course. I leave on Sunday night, and then I will have to leave on Wednesday. Get into Abuja on Thursday, straight into our church service. So for almost 10 years, people didn't know how much I was traveling. And I remember some pastors were asking me, they were like, Reverend Sam, what is this about all these certificates you're gathering? I'm like, I can't explain to you. You don't know the line I need to cross. There is something called the breaker's anointing. Are you ready for that tonight? Are you ready for that tonight? As I'm talking to you right now, I'm sharing my story, but I hope you can look at your own story. And the worst thing the adversary can ever do to you is to sedate you to the reality of your challenges. Make you to feel that you are okay. Never letting you realize the lines that you are yet to cross. You are still here. Every time you want to think about crossing this line, something just comes to weaken your resolve. Something comes to distract you. Someone comes to distract you. What you should have gotten done in the year 1994, you are still yet to do that now. It's 2024. For some persons, it's a medical line. Daddy was diabetic, hypertensive, cancer runs in the bloodline. My heart broke. I pray for people a lot in the area of healing ministry. Sometimes when you see me pray for people with some holy aggression, I'm angry at the devil. I met a 15 or 14 year old girl who was talking about diabetes, shooting herself with insulin. I'm like, what happened to you? And she was like, my grandfather has it. And she said, my mother and my mother's sisters, they all have it. I said, really? And nobody's been able to confront and conquer this? Young girl, it's a line you must cross, and you have to cross it early. And so we were in the service. Prayer was going on, just like a meeting like this. And as prayer was going on, the power of God hit that girl, and she began to vomit things that were fluffy. And she went for her test. That marked the end of diabetes in this girl's life. Listen, that girl is not only married, she is one of the top six in her profession in the United Kingdom. Top six today in the United Kingdom. That was what the adversary doesn't want her to become. The line you have to cross is critical because of what is ahead of the line. You have to cross it. There is no infirmity you should excuse. Sickness is not a gift from God. Come on, let's get this right. Sickness is not a gift from God. Oh, Pastor Sam, I thought God was using it to teach me. Teach you what? How can a good God use a bad thing to raise his children? Sickness is not a gift from God. If sickness is a gift from God, he won't anoint Jesus to take sickness away from us. That would be God fighting against God. So as I speak to you right now, reject it. The reason it has continued is because you accepted it. You have created a theology, what we call accommodative theology. You've created a theology that accommodates this infirmity in your body. So it is there because you allow it. Say with me, I'm crossing the line. Say it again, say I'm crossing the line. Financial lines, I'm crossing the line. Generational systemic poverty, I'm crossing that line. Not enough, just enough scarcity, I'm crossing this line. Indebted to banks, indebted in every way. Come on, say I'm crossing the line. It is into that order today by the grace of God that God is anointing you for. Thank you, Jesus. How I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. Listen to what Pharaoh said, and I'll close with this. When Moses came over to Pharaoh, Exodus chapter 8, Moses said to Pharaoh, let my people go. Let them cross this line. And watch this, please. Don't miss this. Pharaoh said, that's okay. I will let the people go. I don't have a problem with letting you go. You want to go and get married? I don't have a problem with letting you go and get married. I'm not scared with you going to get married. I'm not scared with that. Let the people go. No, I don't have a problem with letting you go to build a house or to own a house. I don't have a problem with letting you go to do that. I'm not afraid of letting you go. Listen to what he said. The only thing that I'm afraid of is that you go very far. He said you can go but not very far. May you not be celebrating going when you should be looking out for very far. May you not be celebrating mediocrity instead of excellence. He said, I will let you go. Go back, sir. I will let you come this far. But the only thing I'm not going to let you do is to go very far. in business, don't go very far. In ministry, don't go very far. Is somebody saying, I will go very far? Yes. Is that rising up on the inside of you? I will go very far. I will go very far. I will go very far. This is not how far I'm going. There is still high. There are still heights to attain. There are still mountains to climb. There are still boundaries to cross. There are limitations to overcome. There are yokes to break and chains to break. And like someone in the house of God, I feel something here. I want someone to make up your mind. I am a line crosser, and I'm going to cross this line. And I'm not just crossing the line. I am going to go very far. Can I hear you shout, I will go very far. Say like a minute, say I will go. Say very far. Say I'm a line crosser. I'm not hearing you like a minute. Say I'm a line crosser. Every demonic line, every satanic line, academic line, I will cross the line. Marital line, I will cross the line. Somebody say I'm a line crosser. That's what God wants to anoint you for here today. Am I talking to somebody in the house of God? Listen, you didn't just come over to this nation. You didn't just come to this land to just go. No. I'm not just going. I'm going to go very far. In my academics, I will go very far. In ministry, I will go very far. In my prayer life, I will go. Is somebody praying in the Holy Ghost, I will go very far. Single lady, I will go very far. But don't forget this, sir. You can't go until you cross the line. Marakos kapalia zopredia. Can you see the line you have to cross? Can you see the line you have to cross? Kamento parkofeliada. I want you to see the line. What is the name of the line? Financial lines, academic lines, marital lines, spiritual lines, whatever kind of line it is, I want you to open your mouth and begin to call that thing by its name and say, I cross the line. I cross the line. I'm a line crosser. I'm crossing for generations to come. I'm crossing for my children. I'm crossing for the next generation. Go ahead and begin to decree and declare, I'm a line crosser. Shande koparata. Open your mouth and decree it. Look at that thing in your life and say to yourself, I will cross this. Ashata baketa. Somebody's on fire for God. That's the power of God there. I'm going beyond the line. Help that woman there. That's the power of God on her already. I am a line crosser. See it and say it. I am crossing this line. The women in your family, they don't get married early. I cross the line. They don't get children. I cross the line. They don't go very far. I cross the line. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Oh, Shabarata, Yerabakosa, Kerabashata, Etameniniendosa, Sibelakandosia. Come on, begin to pray. I am a breaker. I carry the breaker's anointing. I'm going beyond this level. Stand on your feet to pray. Shout to God your Father. Say, I'm a line crosser.
I'm a line crosser. I cross the line. I break the jinx. Hallelujah. In the next 60 seconds to 120 seconds, I want you to remember that from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffered violence, and the men of violence, they take it by. I'm not hearing you, they take it by. Let me say something to you so that you can be helped. I was on Daystar, and then I hear them, they were talking, and they were like, you know, African prayer. I'm like, African prayer? And then I was in Pastor John Hanna's church in Chicago, those of you that followed the 12-hour prayer. And I heard them before I came up to speak, they were talking about African prayer. And when I got to the stage, I said, I don't know what you call African prayer. I say, is that a way to excuse your prayerlessness? I say, because sweetheart, I don't know what you call African prayer. Oh, you know, Africans, they pray with a lot of passion. They pray with a lot of energy. And I ask a question. I say, how did Jesus pray? Donor, how did Jesus pray? He prayed until the sweats of his body were like drops of blood. Am I talking to somebody here? Let me give you an understanding. Take it down. Maybe that's why things have not shifted yet. That's why you've not crossed the line. Don't forget that Jesus is the one that when it comes to Lazarus, who's been dead for days, 3 days, Jesus will just say, hey, Lazarus, come forward. Just one command. They bring him bread and he needs to multiply bread to feed thousands of people. He will just lift it up. Father, I thank you for you. Hear me always. Guys, take it. Go and give it to him. Simple prayers. He comes out, there was a storm. And Jesus will look at the storm. Peace be still. And then just to cross the line into the assignment he came here for 3 hours by theological estimation, because he came to the disciples and said, couldn't you watch with me an hour? And then he went the second time and he came back again. The third time he said, sleep on. May you not hear sleep on. Because there's somebody here, God has been trying to wake you up. And then you wake up. Oh God, it's 2 o'clock. Wake up and pray. You go to sleep again. He wakes you up. By the third time, he says, sleep on. And Peter slept into adversity. Slept into compromise. Beware of sleep when you need to wake up and pray. And Jesus began to pray on one prayer point. Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass away from me. One prayer point, close to 3 hours. And the Bible says the sweat of his body were like drops of blood. Sweats coming down like drops of blood. And the Bible tries to make us understand the kind of prayer that makes things work. The Bible calls it effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man, has tremendous power, makes tremendous power available. And the Bible talks about the fact that Elijah was a man like us. He was not an African. And the Bible says Elijah prayed and prayed again 7 times. One prayer point. 7 times. He will not take no for an answer. He took a posture in the place of prayer and began to pray. The Bible says he kept his head between his knees. Maximum concentration in the place of prayer. Kept his head between his knees and began to call on God. And then prayer with expectation. He calls his servant. Is anything happening in respect to the prayer I've been praying? With respect to the prayer I'm praying. And he comes back and says, sorry, sir. There's nothing. He said, that's not the prayer. That's not the answer I'm expecting. And he goes back to the place of prayer. 7 times. You've only prayed over that matter 2 times and you give up.
Jacob spent the entire night for Israel to come out of Jacob, for a nation to come out of an individual. He wrestled all night. You want greatness to find expression through your life? You want to cross that threshold? I'm inviting you to the place of prayer. And the worst thing that can happen to you is to be weak in the place of prayer. If in this gathering you are unable to pray, what then happens when you get home alone? Let me ask you a question. How many of you have you've noticed the lines you must cross? You know the line you must cross. As I was talking, you know the line you must cross. Don't forget what I told you. In order for this man to cross the line, he could not cross it by himself. Help has to come. The Bible puts it this way. It's not by power, it's not by might, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. Are you ready for this? I'm giving you this moment to pray and say, God, I receive grace to cross the line. And listen, as you are praying, you do that prophetically. See the line. Mention it by its name and say, I receive the grace to cross financial lines. I receive the grace to cross lines of indebtedness, curse lines, spells, any kind of pronouncement that anybody has ever made over your life. This is a moment to cross the line. This is a moment to say, God, I'm crossing the line of delayed marriage. I'm crossing the line of frustration, of confusion. This is the moment, because after now you will be anointed by the Spirit of the Lord. I want you to open your mouth and begin to declare in the name of Jesus, I cross this line. I cross this career line. Father, I receive grace to cross the line. Everyone under the sound of my voice, get aggressive in the place of prayer. You need to take some step forward. Move away from your seat and say, I cross the line. I cross the line. I cross the line. Shate goskata. Ebrando sketaba. I cross the line. Neshande balcombretisa. Embaro setaba. The line your father was not able to cross. The line your mother was not able to cross. Say, Lord, I receive the grace and I cross the line. I cross generational line. I cross bloodlines. Turn your eyes on Jesus and begin to take strength from him. Begin to receive grace from him and say, Lord, I receive grace. I receive wisdom. I receive the anointing. I receive the blessing. I receive the power to cross the line. I'm a line crosser. And the altar is open. If you feel like coming to the altar to pray, you can come to the altar and say, Lord, I receive grace to cross the line. I'm a line crosser. If you're coming to the altar, come to the altar and say, Lord, I'm a line crosser. I'm a line crosser. I'm a jinx breaker. I'm a curse breaker. I'm a spell breaker. Oh, Shadabarosia, Shedamatara, Ekebela Nosa, Subalatom Sabatia, Eraba Combresa. Come on, come on, push in the Holy Ghost, Lekoperenezisa, Irabaton Selamata, Nakongele Besotodia. That's how to pray. Rato Filamasa, Eshadabon Siketa. I cross this line. Yabongeto Shakata. Break us anointing. Break us anointing. I'm a line crosser. I'm going very far. I'm a line crosser. I'm going very far. Yeshamita Labasa. No sickness in your body. No disease in your body.
Come on, somebody push in the Holy Ghost. Say it to yourself. I cross a line for my children. I cross a line for the next generation. I cross a line. Yananda kosa kecha shambra kosa irabatombre kesota. This disease will not continue. This affliction will not continue. This reproach will not continue. I receive the grace to cross the line. To cross the line. Shadam batosi. Yes. Come on, go ahead and talk to God. Say, I cross this line. I cross this line. The hand of the Lord is upon you. The hand of the Lord is on you now. The hand of the Lord is upon you. The hand of the Lord is upon you. The hand of the Lord just came upon you. The hand of the Lord just came on you. You will be the first. You will be the pace setter. You will be the trendsetter. You will be the pathfinder. Come on. Let the fire rise. Let the power rise. Help that woman. The power of God is on her. Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost. Something is happening. Holy Ghost. Touch. Touch. Eyamashata. Yerabasha. Cry to God. You are close. Push. 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 You are there. It's time to break through. Shadalabada. Erabashata. Erabashaniata. Erabashaniata. Endabo Shadamata Rabba. Erabako Silamandesa. Eshondre Tosca. Grace is on you. 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 Shandarabasoka. Erabashata. Eh Shalalabasha. Erabasonde Rabashata. Erabashata. The breakers anointed. The breakers anointed. Come on, somebody. Jesus, Jesus, Hayanabosha, Erabashata, Erabashariat, Erabashekatea, Endaboshela Mandes, Ekamerodosita, Erabashana Mandes, Erabasondre Hekatosa, Eshandre Hekatoriandosa, Oh, Shadabatosta. Come on, somebody pray. Somebody pray. Shada baroska. Shada boska tani. Eraba shatera. Eraba shata boska. Eshandre hesotalia. Eraba sharia dos. Emarosande ke rabasha. Emorakate e shabur. Eraba kombre hete yama. Eraba bandos. Shekabosha, superadabos, superadabosha, superadabosha, superadabosha. The breakers anointing, the breakers anointing, the breakers anointing, the breakers anointing. It's on you now. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hey.
Shadabarados. It is broken. It is broken. It is broken. It is broken. Shadamos. Oh, Sigarabada. That's the power of God. That's the power of God. That's the power of God. Shadadadabosa. That's the power of God there. Jesus. Shadamonche Rabasha. I break it for you. I break it over you. I break it over you. I set you free. I set you free. I set you. Jesus. Cross the line. Cross that 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 line. Cross the line. Cross the line. Shanaboskata. Eraba Shataria. Eraba Koserabasha. Thank you. I'm a line crosser. I'm a line crosser. I'm a line crosser.
I'm a line crosser.
That's who I am. That's who I am. No more power holding you back. I'm a line crosser.
I'm a line crosser.
That's who you're becoming. Holy Ghost. I'm a line crosser. Jesus. Such an anointing on your life. Such an anointing on you. Such an anointing on your life. Holy Ghost, such a lobaroshata. I'm a line crosser. I'm a line crosser. I'm a line crosser. I'm a line crosser. Such an anointing. Such an anointing. Such an anointing. Cross the line. Cross the line. Cross the line. I'm a line crosser. Saturday. I'm a line crosser. Shut up my soul. I'm a line crosser. Hey, Jesus, such an anointing on you, such an anointing on you, such an anointing on you, such an anointing on you. You're a line crosser. 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 Jesus. Holy Ghost, you're a line crosser. Holy Ghost, make a line crosser. Cross a line. 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 In the name of Jesus. Cross a line. You cross the line. I break the curse. I break the spell. Cross the line. You are destined for more. Cross the line. Today marks your turning point. You cross the line. You cross the line. It is done. Cross the line. Cross the line. Cross the line. Pick her up. Cross the line. Bring her up here. Cross the line. Shadadonosia. Leave her here. Yeratoske parata. You cross that line. Sembre hekatos. My God.
Are you here for prayer? Lift your hands.
I'm a line crosser.
I'm a line crosser.
I'm a line crosser.
I'm a line crosser.
Say it like you mean it.
I'm a line crosser.
I'm a line crosser.
That's who you are.
I'm a line crosser. Look at that. Look at the anointing on you. That's who you are. Bring God up for me. You gotta cross that line. You're a line cross. I release that grace on you.
Sweetheart, it's your time too. It's your time too. It's your time too. It's your time too.
You cross that line. Cross it. Cross it. Cross it. Cross it. They don't want you to cross it, but here comes. Here comes the anointing for you to cross it. Here comes the grace to cross it. Cross that line. Cross it by grace. Cross it by the Spirit. Cross it by grace. Cross the line. Cross the line. Cross the line. I break the curse. I break the spell. Cross the line. In the name of Jesus. Cross the line.
Yes, Lord.
I'm a line crosser.
I'm a line crosser.
I'm a line crosser.
Listen.
Listen,
Mama. Can I have, sir, can I have the man on red there? Come quickly, sir.
Ooh.
Just a baroche shaking. Spirit of God. Hallelujah. Can I, the man on red, sir, can I see you, sir? Yes. Huh? Oh, my God.
So saith the Spirit of a living God, the time has come, the moment is now. For thus saith the Spirit of a living God, I put on you now a breaker's anointing.
Amen.
And I see you crossing the line.
Amen.
And I see that there are, put your hands on my back, put your hands behind him. That's a picture of what I see. And the Lord said, as you take your steps forward, the Lord said, as you cross the line, he said, you are actually causing many to cross the line.
Yeah.
So today, I put upon you the grace to cross the line.
Amen.
Whatever the line is,
amen.
Whatever the line is,
amen.
Grace is on you,
amen.
To cross the line. Grace is on you to go beyond the limits. Grace is on you to go beyond the boundaries. Become a trailblazer. Become a pathfinder. Become a trendsetter. In the name of Jesus.
Lift your hands up, woman of God. For the Lord said, I have called you to deeper places. He said, I've called you to deeper places. He said, you are still playing around the shores. For in this season, I hear the voice of the Lord saying, come up higher. I'm hearing the Lord also saying, launch into the deep. You are leaving the familiar terrain. And now you are moving into the unfamiliar. For I hear the Lord saying, you are someone who doesn't like to take unnecessary risk. But the Lord said, the journey that I'm calling you into now will require that you give up calculating, and you need to put your trust in me. For in this season, saith the Lord, I am taking you beyond the limits. I'm taking you beyond the bounds. For I am bringing you into a place you've never been. I'm bringing you into a dimension you've never experienced, saith the Spirit of a living God. For in this hour, saith the Lord, I put upon you a new, my God, I put upon you a new anointing to be a limit breaker. To be a trendsetter, to be a pathfinder, to be one who will go before and others will come behind. This is your moment, saith the Spirit of a living God. Can I have you, man? Let me have your hands. Just put your right hand on my hands. Put your right hand up. Turn it. Yes. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. The Lord said, what you've been struggling to overcome. The Lord said, now grace is on you too. That's it. That's it. That's it, mama. That's it. That's it. That's it. That's it. Grace is on you now to cross it. Now receive grace to cross it. 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 The Lord said you can cross it now. 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 Thank you, Lord Jesus. I want to pray. I want to pray for four men here. Four men. And as I say this, you will know you're the one I'm speaking to. Four men here. And let me say it clear so you know I'm talking with you. You know how God leads us here. There are four men here. Please listen carefully. Don't just come. There are four men here. The Lord said to me, your greatest pain is that your life is almost turning out like your father. And it's what you don't like. You don't want it. And you're almost like, life is almost like repeating the same cycle. And you're saying, Pastor Sam, I want to be the line breaker. I want to be the line crosser. I want to break that limit. I want to cross the line that my fathers could not cross. I want to be the Abraham that goes beyond Haran into Canaan. Where's the man I'm talking to? Four of you. I want you to come quickly. Come quickly. Come quickly. God bless you, sirs. Say it, ma'am. No problem. We'll pray over that. I'm a line cross.
I'm a line cross.
Say it again. Who is that? Your son. His life is stagnant, just like his father. You're a man and you want to cross lines that bloodline generations before you have not been able to cross. Please get ready. It's going to be a general anointing service here, but I just feel I should do this quickly. I'm a line crosser. Shana matches. By the same token, same grace that has done it for me, same grace rest upon you, sir. Become a line crosser. Cross the line. The grace of God comes upon you to cross the line. Cross the line. In the name of Jesus. 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 Cross the line. Shimaroske maratas. Cross the line. Zembra hasokateria. Cross the line. You won't end up like daddy end up. You won't end up like they ended up. Cross the line. Cross the line. Cross the line. Cross the line. You're coming inside. Ooh. Come, sir. Jesus, Jesus, go beyond them, go beyond all of them, cross the line, cross the line, cross the line, cross the line, cross the line. Answer him. I break the curse. I break the spell. Cross the line. Jesus. Cross the line. In the name of Jesus. Cross the line. In the name of Jesus. I've not prayed for you, sir. Cross the line, sir. In the name of Jesus. Cross the line. The contention is over. Cross the line. Come quickly. I don't know why I'm drawn to the men in this house. I'm drawn to the men in America. cross the line. Cross the line. Who is this? Your son. 20 years of the same old, same cycle. In the name of Jesus, I break the spell. I break it. In the name of Jesus, I break it. In the name of Jesus, I break it. In the name of Jesus, I break it. I break it. I break it. I prayed for him. Yes. We're going to have, we just wanted it to be very fast today. Take it down. Take it down. Take it down. I said to you yesterday, I don't know what you all did before this conference. You seem to have a way of getting me into things I don't want to do. You all went on a fast right before I came here, so that God can disrupt me. Who is that, your son? He's not going to end up like his father. In Jesus' name. One of the greatest challenges in America is fatherlessness. Right? One of the greatest challenges in America is fatherlessness. Children, sons and daughters growing up in homes without father figures, making our sons to be over-mothered and under-fathered, perpetuating the cycle of fatherlessness. Men coming into the lives of women not knowing how to perform the role of a father and a man because they never saw it happen. Men at little stress, just little pressure, leave the home because it's what they saw. But there's a new generation of men God is raising in this country. I hear some women saying, Pastor Sam, do you know what the Bible says? Like mother, like daughter, the Bible says that proverb shall no longer be heard amongst us. As I was praying for the men, I hear in my spirit women saying, Pastor Sam, I don't want to end up like my mom. I want to cross the line. You are in that kind of situation. Quickly, let me see you. Wave your hand. Okay. What? Okay, so I can call you out here. I can call you out here. All right? Would you lift your hands up? Now place it on yourself. You, listen. Listen. Take it out. I want all of you to think about what is going on here today. I wish we can take all this picture, take pictures of you all and send it home saying to mama, I love you, but I don't want to end up like you. And here's what I'm asking myself. In 10, 20 years from now, I hope your daughter will not be standing on an altar saying, I don't want to end up like you too. That's why you must cross the line. So when a prayer is called like this, your daughter will say, that's not for me. My mom is everything I want to be. I only even hope I can be like my mom, because my mother's shoe is too big for me to even occupy. That's what God is about to do for you now. Are you ready? Can I pray in just 60 seconds? I need your amen to be as strong as you have a desire to break the limit. Is that okay? Father, in the name of Jesus, I stand over you today and I decree and declare that every limit your mother was not able to cross, let the hand of the Lord rest upon you. Let the Spirit of the Lord come upon you. Let the grace of God come upon you. Today I decree and declare, you cross the line. You cross that line. Receive the courage to cross the line. Receive the wisdom to cross the line. Receive the connection to cross the line. Receive the revelation to cross the line. Receive such grace right now. In Jesus' mighty name we'll pray.